I'm Corey Johnson, and this is Bloomberg Technology. Well, coming up, Tesla gets a boost of cash. Shares on the rise after the Chinese internet giant Tencent buys a stake in Tesla. Plus, Intel weighs into the future of Moore's Law. It's not dead. The chip maker says it's going to maintain its edge in competition with Moore's Law. And Uber in the spotlight again, this time by their own choice. The company out with its first diversity report. Shocker. There seems to be a deficit. First, to our lead. A cash boost for Tesla. Tencent buys a 5% stake in the company valued at $1.8 billion. It's part of a round of investment that the company already announced. They're going to borrow, raise some debt and sell some stock. But could there be a partnership in the future? The statement of Bloomberg, the Chinese internet giant, said, quote, Tencent and Tesla have no detailed cooperation plan at the moment and may have some consideration in the future depending on how the ties develop. Tesla stock recovered from earlier losses in the news, up about 3%. Joining me from San Francisco, Kevin Carter. He's the founder of EMQQ, an emerging markets ETF. Tencent, about 8% of that ETF. And in New York, Bloomberg technology reporter Selena Wang. Selena, let me start with you, and I'm going to ask Kevin the same question. So, Kevin, you can practice. Because the question is, what the heck is Tencent thinking? What do they want out of only a 5% stake, but a big stake?
Tencent has a process where they look for the best, highest, fastest growing companies, and they make an investment in it. They have a far-ranging portfolio. They've invested in Didi, invested in Lyft, a bunch of map AI technology companies. They're really charting their plan to take ownership of this world of connected electric vehicles in the future. And they're not the only players in China. Baidu's been investing heavily here. So has Alibaba. They've recently struck a partnership with one of China's biggest auto manufacturers. They're slated to come out with a connected car in the near future. So it doesn't come at all that much of a surprise.
Again, the idea here is that these are financial investments, maybe not necessarily partnership, but maybe a stake at the place at the table.
I think it's unclear at this point. I mean, partnerships are definitely, sources are telling me, they would not be surprised if there were partnerships. I mean, you could easily see WeChat integrations into the connected car. I mean, WeChat is great for Tesla to have their feet in. I mean, they have 900, about 900
million users. Because we really want people texting more while they're driving. let me ask you, Kevin, the same question. So Tencent has about $18 billion U.S. On the balance sheet. So a $2 billion investment, it matters. It's a small percentage of that, but still it is a legitimate investment here. What do you think they want out of this?
Well, I think, first of all, Tencent has made dozens, in fact, close to 150 investments in both private and public companies of all different types, but all, you know, internet related. And this one marks one of several investments they've made into the automotive space. And I think that, you know, we've seen this all over the news here. I mean, there's a number of major players in related industries, whether it's Tesla, whether it's the Ubers and Lyfts of the world, the Didis. There's a change going on in the way that people and products are moved around, and it's in its very, very earliest stages, and no one's really quite sure how it's going to play out. Are the automakers going to be the players? Are the manufacturers like Tesla going to be the players? And I think, you know, as was said, I think they just want to have a seat at the table, and maybe not in the boardroom, but at least they have a toe in the water position to see how things play out.
So then it also helps them get cash out of China, right? I mean, we know that individuals have done all kinds of things with real estate, Canadian real estate, there's a whole other story, but a lot of money fleeing China on an individual level. This lets the company have investments outside of China, so not as necessarily tied to the Chinese economy and been able to participate somewhere else in all these, as he mentioned, over 100 investments.
Definitely. All of China's biggest companies, they all want to have a seat at the table, as Kevin said. They also want to get more capital abroad. It's unclear what the process is going to be like for Tencent here, but we're seeing, as we speak, Ant Financial is having some troubles with MoneyGram. Some Euronet, which is also making a bid, is saying that it's going to have some issues with the CFIUS approval process. But yes, as you said, this is a big deal for Chinese companies, and it's a really great way for Tencent to have their stake in a very big, fast-growing U.S. company.
And Kevin, to you on Tencent, I mean, you know, I think, you know, we forget that, or maybe some of us forget that China is the largest car market in the world, but bar none. Do you think that Tencent is part of your, when you do the work on this company, do you look at this as a business that should be in automotive in different ways?
Well, they are already invested in the automobile business in other ways. There, they own a stake in Auto Home, which is sort of an auto trader. They're recently invested in Yintai, which is the leading auto finance company. But I think that, you know, one of the parts of the story here that's important is, while China is the largest car market in terms of new sales right now, its per capita number of cars is still quite low versus the United States in particular. And but this number of cars they have become a problem. I mean, in many of the major cities, there's restrictions on, you know, which days you can drive depending on your license plate number. We've all seen the stories of the, you know, days and weeks long traffic jams in certain parts of China. So I think more than any country, to the extent that the autonomous vehicle takes some of the traffic off of the road and cars off the road, I mean, I think it makes a lot of sense for China as a country to be embracing autonomous vehicles, which I think is a lot of what this investment's about.
Fascinating stuff. And I want to change topics just a little bit, Selina, because you had a great story today. It was interesting about Amazon and the focus that Amazon's got on the Middle East with a pretty big acquisition, we think.
Yeah, definitely. It was a pretty large acquisition. We don't know exactly what the amount was. They had at one point been in talks for something like $650 million, but we think it's probably closer to $1 billion this time. This is a big deal for Amazon.
Even for Amazon, that's a lot of money, $1 billion.
Exactly. I mean, they see the Middle East as an emerging, growing market. This gets them a company with huge brand presence. It's one of the biggest e-commerce companies
in the Middle
East.
Or souk.com.
Yeah, souk.com. And it's a great way for Amazon to get an entry point there. And I think when they were thinking of the build versus buy question, in this case, it made a lot of sense to purchase the company.
Really, because it's not really Amazon style. Amazon certainly has done lots of little acquisitions, but buying a company that's in an adjacent business and making it their own, it's just not the Amazon way.
Exactly. But in this instance, if you look at what Souq has already built, they have this courier system, a pickup drop-off system. That logistics infrastructure is probably pretty difficult to recreate in the Middle East. And Amazon's probably looking at this deal and thinking, this makes a lot of sense. And I'm sure that they will probably evaluate other opportunities and other markets that they have no footprint in, and they might come up to that same conclusion.
Selina Wang, thank you very much. We appreciate it. Bloomberg Tech Reporter Selina Wang and Kevin Carter, of course, the founder of EMQQ. I was going to bigger picture of the markets after the Dow snapping an 8-day losing streak. Bloomberg News stocks reporter Abigail Doolittle joins us right now. Abigail, Tuesday trading, was this a resumed Trump rally with the EPA news today?
Great question there, Corey. Irrespective of what was behind it, it was certainly a bullish day for stocks. The major averages actually opened slightly down, and then were trading in mixed fashion, and then they shot higher. And Corey, I think that what was behind this was actually the 10-year yield starting to climb higher. This set off a rally in the banks. The banks led. But it wasn't all about technology that caused the best rally for the major averages here in the U.S. since March 1st. We also had some of the tech and internet stocks trading sharply higher, really helping out the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ in particular, including Apple, Facebook, and Amazon. Apple and Facebook, in fact, closed at new record highs. And Apple, get this, Stephen Mulvanich over UBS, he thinks that Apple could be a $200 stock over the next 2 to 3 years, especially if they really focus on innovation along with accelerating buybacks. But the question here is, Corey, Apple, from a technical perspective, has looked pretty stretched. Caroline and I have looked at this in the past. But we have a great chart that suggests that perhaps more bullish trading could be ahead for Apple. This is G#BTV7224. Very colorful. It's using a new indicator within the Bloomberg called the Chameleon Indicator that blends all sorts of technical indicators, but simplifies it by showing bullish trading action in green, bearish in red, and then when there's uncertainty, we see yellow and pink. Outside of that boxed-in area back in 2012, this indicator has been pretty solid on Apple, and right now it's all green, suggesting that perhaps these gains, these record gains for Apple, may just continue and in turn help the major averages, Corey.
And we also see a bid for a stock that had been hurting today, name I don't spend a lot of time working on, but Accenture. What was the big move there all about?
Well, the big move there, Accenture finished up more than 1.5%, the best day since December 7th. And the big news there is Oracle. There was lots of chatter that Oracle could buy out Accenture, that maybe they're looking at it for a services company. But I did reach out to Bloomberg Intelligence analyst Anurag Rana. He said he thinks that this is pretty unlikely, mainly for the valuation, the price tag being so big. When we take a long-term look at Accenture, really since it went public back in 2001, this stock is up in a huge way. It's nearly an $80 billion market cap company, again, speaking to that big price tag. However, Anurag Rana did say that he heard CEO Larry Ellison is looking for perhaps services companies, some smaller services company. And on this chatter today, we did see some of the other smaller services companies rally, including HP Enterprises, Computer Sciences, and CGI Group. So I'm guessing, Corey, we'll be hearing more about this story on a stock, a company that you don't focus on too much, but who knows?
Oracle... I mean, it's trading at 2.6 times its earnings growth rate. It doesn't really look like a great valuation. There, but interesting stuff. Abigail Doolittle, thank you very much, Bloomberg News stocks reporter. All right, a story that we're watching. It's the biggest grab for the global market to the date. Square expanding into the UK. At least for the moment, less than 5% of Square's sales are outside of the US. They do have a presence in Canada, Japan, and Australia. Coming up, President Trump rolling back the energy policies of President Obama. What this means next for clean tech. And a reminder that all episodes of Bloomberg Technology live streamed on the Twitter. Check us out at Bloomberg Tech TV. Weekdays 5 o'clock on the East Coast, 2 o'clock on the West Coast. This is Bloomberg. President Trump signing an executive order today intending to scale back the clean power, make America energy independent, and restore coal industry jobs. But is clean tech really the enemy of coal? Joining us right now from our D.C. bureau, Jen Deloey, who covers the energy industry for Bloomberg News. Jen, we just talked on Bloomberg Radio a little while ago, but I'll ask you some of the same questions. I think it matters. Is America doesn't import any coal, so does encouraging coal make America less energy independent or more energy independent or have any impact whatsoever?
It's important to note that this order actually is much broader than just coal, even though Trump today framed it very much in the language of helping coal miners. The core of this order that Trump signed is dismantling the Clean Power Plan, which forced coal, largely eroded coal's market share in the power sector. But he's also lifting other restrictions that have limited production of oil and gas on federal land.
Well, let's talk about those one by one here. So the coal industry stuff, there's a lot of suggestions that requirements on monitoring the price of coal or the pollutions in coal has been hurting that industry and that money will suddenly start flowing into that. Is that likely to happen here?
Analysts don't think so. And partly that's because, the coal industry is up against a raft of pollution regulations. It's not just regulations on carbon dioxide that are affected by what Trump is doing today. It's regulations on mercury and traditional criteria air pollutants that aren't going away. So that has been, one of the primary headwinds for coal in the electric sector and one of the main reasons you see utilities going to natural gas and renewables, which have the advantage not just of being cleaner, but also increasingly their lower cost options as well.
It seems that the price of natural gas is the most important driver of the choices that are being made and that you've got energy companies across the country who for a decade have been switching away from coal towards natural gas, not because it was cleaner, although it is, but because it's cheaper.
Right. I mean, the economic story, that's the real challenge here for coal. No matter what Trump does with the Clean Power Plan, he can't change those fundamental economics for coal producers. Obviously, there's coal that's used for steel. That's something where maybe he sees an opportunity to create a steel manufacturing renaissance in the United States and to drive coal production there. But in the power sector, it's a challenging thing to do.
Yeah, and furthermore, I wonder what this does mean for the future of clean tech and what changes will affect wind and solar.
I think wind and solar developers, I talked to a lot of them here in Washington, D.C., the lobbyists for those industries and companies. They think that they tick a lot of the president's boxes. I mean, they offer jobs, they offer domestic energy security and independence. So they're really telling that story to the Trump administration and, just not pitching themselves as climate leaders so much as part of his economic success story. And that seems to be pretty salient with the administration right now.
Yeah, and it also seems to be that not unlike manufacturing, with coal, the jobs that would come back if there was more mining to be done would be more automated, more use of machinery, less use of human beings, so that these are not as many jobs that come back, even if the same amount of productivity would be happening.
Right. Well, what we've seen with the coal mining sector for decades really is an erosion of jobs because of increased mechanization. I mean, the image of, a miner going in down underground, with a pickaxe, that's really antiquated. I mean, now you have bulldozers, you have, mechanized diggers that are out there where in fields, in open pits, in mountaintop removal sites. It's a completely different picture, and mechanization has really eaten away at those jobs. Even with the Clean Power Plan gone, those jobs aren't necessarily coming back.
At least he didn't bring back lead paint and DDT. So we got that for us. All right, Bloomberg's Jen Deloey, thank you very much. All right, still ahead, are you psyched to share your browser history? Just a little bit? The U.S. Congress is set to vote on broadband privacy rules. Why your web history could be at risk next. And a feature we'd like to bring to your attention, our interactive TV function. You can find a TV Go on the Bloomberg. Watch us live, plus see previous interviews or any of the stocks or Bloomberg functions we're talking about. Check it out. TV, go. This is Bloomberg. All right, the House is set to overturn broadband privacy rules put forth by the FCC just months ago. The Senate voted to scrap the rules last week. But consumer advocates are worried about your browser history. Proponents of less government regulations say these are just rules that overreach and put internet service providers as a disadvantage against websites and apps. Joining us from D.C. right now, Jon Leibowitz, former FTC chairman, and the co-chairman of the 21st Century Privacy Coalition, a group funded by Comcast and other broadband providers. The argument that I've heard is that Comcast, Time Warner Cable, companies we all know and love, just kidding about that part, but these companies really feel like they're at an unfair disadvantage against Google and Facebook and the like. Is that right?
Well, look, I would say members of the 21st Century Privacy Coalition are very strong supporters of consumer privacy. And they firmly believe in that companies have to be transparent, disclose what information they're collecting and how it's being used, and they should be held accountable for honoring their commitments to consumers. I would say that the FTC, my former agency, sent a comment to Corey to the FCC, and it was at that time a Democratic-controlled agency. And they pointed out 27 separate criticisms of the FCC rule, not all of which were addressed. And the most significant one is the fact that privacy protections, although they are critically important, should be technology neutral. And in fact, the FTC wrote a report in 2012. It was praised fairly widely, including by privacy advocates. That called for limits on data collection, right, and technology neutrality.
So let me ask, currently, does a cable provider, an ISP, does Comcast, Time Warner Cable, do they have to tell me if they want to look at my browsing history?
Do they have to tell you? No, but they've all made commitments. First of all, they don't look at browsing history right now, but they've all made commitments that they will not sell that data, certainly in a personal sense. And if they don't honor those commitments, they're in violation of the law. They're 47 state AGs.
Well, I'm not talking about selling it. I'm talking about using it for themselves, using it for whatever purposes they might want to use it.
For internal use, sure. For billing purposes, for law enforcement purposes, they might actually find some interesting patterns and things about the information they collect and use that to benefit consumers. Right? I mean, that's sort of what edge providers like Google and Facebook do.
And so the edge providers, however, have to notify the person that you're using. Now, someone might just click on accepting the terms on Facebook or Google, and one can argue whether that's truly a notification or whether someone really understands what they're participating at that point. But is that sort of the heart of it, that the rules are different for an Apple, for a Google, for a Facebook than they are for a Comcast or a Verizon?
Well, the rules certainly would be different if the FCC proposal stays in place. And we think the FCC proposal is pretty fundamentally flawed.
It's interesting, too, because we do see companies like AT&T moving forward with this Dish business and thinking more about being a content provider. We look at everything that's happening where suddenly Verizon is both AOL and Yahoo, as well as being the ISP. So they really do want to go much more head-to-head with Google and Facebook.
Well, I mean, I think what you might see going forward, and I think particularly if this rule is modified or overturned, is competition for privacy, which would be a good thing for consumers, and more innovation, which is also a good thing for Americans. So, that is the hope.
To say that this rule that removes some privacy protections gives more competition for privacy, I would argue that no one's pushing to get more privacy. The push here is to get less privacy.
Well, but I would say it's not entirely certain. I think if you place restrictions on an ISP or a broadband provider, And they result in, you know, higher prices or less innovation. I just don't think consumers are necessarily benefited from it. And, of course, the FCC still has the authority to bring privacy cases, as it has done over the last several years under the previous administration. I hope they'll continue to do that where it's appropriate.
But again, this is about taking away privacy, not adding more for the ISPs.
Well, I think it's about more than taking away privacy. I think
so it's about taking away privacy and something else. Yes, I would agree.
Well, so I think we're in agreement there. I think it's about you know, replacing or undoing what we think is a flawed privacy proposal that was passed on a partisan vote at the FTC. Our approach was generally try to have bipartisan rulemakings and decisions. They're more enduring. And you know, the FCC has the ability, if it wants to go back and write a new privacy proposal, it could do that. And so I think we're not quite certain what the future would hold, there's a reasonable chance that the future will be more promising for consumers. But I certainly see your question. There's no doubt about that.
Jon Leibowitz, I really appreciate your time. Former FTC chairman, Jon Leibowitz, thank you. All right, coming up, Intel's Executive Vice President of Manufacturing Operations, Stacy Smith. We're going to dig into what's next for this $300 billion chipmaster. And if you like Bloomberg News, check us out on the radio. You can hear Bloomberg Radio app, Bloomberg.com, the U.S. on Sirius XM, station 119. This is Bloomberg.
I'm Elisa Parenti, and you're watching Bloomberg Technology. Let's begin with a check of your first word news. The UK is standing by its statement that now isn't the time for a Scottish referendum. May says the focus for now is on the Brexit, which officially begins tomorrow. Defiant Scottish lawmakers voted today on a new referendum on independence to be held within the next 2 years. Germany wants a hard commitment from the UK that it will not look to renege on its EU bill during the crucial two-year negotiating period to exit the bloc. The UK is the union's second biggest net payer. The divorce bill could be as high as $65 billion. The wife of French presidential candidate François Fillon is facing preliminary charges over parliamentary jobs investigators suspect she never performed. The Fillons have denied wrongdoing. His poll numbers have plunged since the scandal broke. Fillon's also charged with misusing funds. South Africa's finance minister, Pravin Gordhan, is back in the country today after being abruptly ordered to leave a trade promotion trip to Britain and the U.S. President Jacob Zuma is believed to have mentioned firing him. Gordhan today said he, quote, hasn't resigned. The U.N. says three African nations, South Sudan, Somalia, and Nigeria, are on the brink of famine. Officials say 16 million people are at risk. It is the largest humanitarian crisis in 70 years. Global news 24 hours a day, powered by more than 2,600 journalists and analysts in more than 120 countries. I'm Elisa Parenti. This is Bloomberg. It's just after 5:30 p.m. Tuesday here in New York, already 8:30 Wednesday morning in Sydney. I'm joined by Bloomberg's Paul Allen with a look at the markets. Paul, good morning to you.
Good morning, Elisa. Well, a very positive lead-in from the U.S. is shaping up to be a positive day around the Asia-Pacific today. New Zealand currently trading for 30 minutes and looking good, up a quarter of 1%. We're seeing some strength in Nikkei futures as well, and ASX futures also pointing up a quarter of 1%. Plenty to watch on the markets locally, particularly the retailer Myer. Today, the mystery buyer of a 10% stake in the department store chain must be revealed, according to law. We saw Myer shares pop by about 18% on Monday before pulling back a little on Tuesday. Also, the state of Queensland will be mopping up after Category 4 Cyclone Debbie. 20% of all coal output from the Bowen Basin has been halted. That basin in Queensland is the world's largest coal-producing region. Elsewhere, keep an eye on Toshiba holding a board meeting today on the Westinghouse bankruptcy, and China Construction Bank will announce earnings as well. I'm Paul Allen in Sydney. More from Bloomberg Technology next.
This is Bloomberg Technology, and I'm Corey Johnson. As we mentioned at the top of the show, Tesla shares on the rise today, the highest levels in over a month. After Tencent announcing that it took down 5% of Tesla in the company's most recent stock offering. Tesla shares up 30% year to date, boosted by the aforementioned capital raise and anticipation of the Model 3. Moore's Law is still on track, according to who else? Intel. The company says that its rivals have not closed the gap on manufacturing leadership. The world's largest semiconductor maker is taking aim at TSMC, Taiwan Semiconductor, and Samsung's abilities in a $300 billion market. Joining us right now from San Francisco, Stacy Smith, Intel's Executive Vice President of Manufacturing Operations and Sales, sitting where I normally sit. I'm sitting where I don't know who normally sits here. Stacy, thanks for coming in today. We do appreciate it. You guys did a big event today where you talked about Moore's Law. But last week I did something with Craig Barrett, and he mocked me, basically. He said, guys like you, Corey, have been saying Moore's Law is dead for 20 years. It's more than that. The speculation is that semiconductors can't get twice as fast and a half as expensive every 18 or 24 months, but you guys are still pulling it off.
Yeah. I mean, the rumors of Moore's Law have been around for a long time, even 25 years ago. But what we showed today was data that, for us, Moore's Law is alive and well. It continues to drive costs down and performance up, and it's the driver of our business, and frankly, it's a big driver of the economy.
It certainly has, and it's unquestionably changed the world, although it's really not a law of science, right? It's just essentially a marketing goal and a scientific research goal, yes?
Yeah, I'd say actually Moore's Law is more of an economics law. What it says is that you can double the number of transistors on a piece of silicon every 2 years. And what that allows us to do is either improve the capability of products or reduce the cost of those products. And so it was an observation by Gordon back in 1965. And then the smart technologists have just been keeping that marching forward, for 50 years.
So what's the most important, say, two or three innovations that you see in Intel's roadmap that are going to allow this to continue?
Yeah, so for us, when we look at the complexity of advancing Moore's Law, we're now employing something called hyperscaling. And so what that means is that we're getting bigger improvements generation by generation, and that's allowing us to keep on the track of Moore's Law. And there's a lot of technology that underlies that, but it is, in essence, it's taking longer to go from node to node, but we're taking much bigger steps, and that gives us the historical benefit that powers our business.
What are the chemical processes that are different in your sort of next generation that you're looking forward to?
Yeah, I mean, as you just said, everything changes in terms of how you do process technology. And so we unveiled a lot today. This was actually the first time we've done an event like this in over a decade, because we're normally pretty secretive about these kinds of things. But we talked about transistor structures. We talked about some of the process steps that we use to give us exquisite control that allows us to do double patterning in the factories. And so we went through a lot of technology disclosures. I think for the non-technologists in the room, it might have been a little bit too much, but it really showed where we're heading, and it allowed us to align the industry around some key technologies, because we need their support to continue Moore's Law as we go forward.
All right, well, geek me out on one. Just tell me one that really got you jazzed when it first sort of found actually applicable science that you can put to work.
Yeah, so one of the key things that we talked about today is something where it's a multi-die interconnect bridge, and so EMIB, so in is what we call it for short, which is a very catchy name. And what this allows us to do, it gives us a very high-speed interconnect so that we can take products from different process technologies or even products from different companies, put them together into one package, and create entirely new classes of products.
And that's so on a singular chip? Is that a singular chip?
Yeah, so it's multiple dies that can come from different places,
okay,
but you put them together with a very high-speed interconnect, and that allows us what we call it is heterogeneous mixing and matching of capabilities. And so we can pull like a modem from one generation of technology, graphics from another, a CPU from another, put them together into a very high-performance package, and create a cadence of innovation that is different from what we've ever been able to do before.
And so these are sort of like the dies sort of stacked on top of each other, like record albums in one of those machines in a diner or whatever?
In this case, they'll actually be next to each other.
Yeah.
So you do very small die, you put them next to each other with this very fast-speed interconnect.
It's really wild stuff. It's sort of amazing, because one does understand why it's hard to believe that it can continue to get so much faster and that this law can continue to perform itself. But it's a great challenge that Intel seems to meet every you know, every few years. But I think what's also interesting, though, is that the way chips are used are different now, and that the drivers that Intel once controlled, where it was data centers and PCs, are not as maybe relevant in a mobile world and an Internet of Things world. Is that fair to say? I mean, you still need it on the back end with a data center, certainly, but maybe not sensors in a stoplight or in a car.
So the interesting thing is that leadership process technology, which is what we talked about today, is applicable obviously in the high end of the market. So think of it in machine learning and artificial intelligence in the data center. It's applicable in the high end of the client market. But it's also really important as you start thinking about making devices smaller and more energy efficient. And so actually, I think leading edge process technology is more applicable today than it ever has been. You just use it in different ways. One of the slides I showed today is that the high-end portion of the foundry market, the leading-edge portion of the foundry market, has been growing at a 14% CAGR over the last 10 years. And that's really being driven by, you know, mobile chips that are going into high-end phones and Internet of Things applications.
That's really interesting. So you're seeing that across the board at the high end, because it doesn't necessarily translate when you sort of see these companies all slung together and all the kinds of things they're doing.
Yeah, so no, we're seeing more and more of the overall silicon that's being produced in the world is going towards the high end. And it's, again, because people want performance and they want energy efficiency. And being at the leading edge enables both of those things.
Very cool stuff. Stacy Smith, EVP of Manufacturing Operations and Sales at Intel. Appreciate your time. Thank you.
Great talking to you.
All right. Facebook's copying Snapchat yet again, this time with its main Facebook app. Facebook users will be able to post pictures and videos that disappear after 24 hours. That sound familiar? Well, they can also add dozens of filters and effects, selfie masks, the things that Snap call lenses, of course. This is after adding Snap-like features to Instagram, Facebook Messenger, and WhatsApp. Of course, after the introduction of Instagram Stories, we later learned that Snapchat's user growth plummeted. All right, coming up, Bill Nye. Yes, Bill Nye, the space guy. He's going to join us with words of wisdom for President Trump on what NASA should be focused on. We'll talk about human Mars missions and the importance of Earth science studies next. This is Bloomberg. Another edition of Out of This World. Former science guy turned Planetary Society CEO Bill Nye has some free advice for President Trump. His nonpartisan space interest group has issued 5 recommendations for the new administration as it takes the reins of NASA. Some we know Trump intends to leave in place, like the goal of a manned mission to Mars. But other areas like science research, not so much. Trump wants to forge a new path and cut spending. Nye joined us from Los Angeles to explain why the Planetary Society offered its advice to Donald Trump.
What's happened a few times in the past, previous administrations have just chopped an existing program and start it over. But we think all the programs that are in work right now are worthy or worthy enough to keep in the pipeline and then keep Mars, the planet Mars. This is like a real thing. Keep the planet Mars as the focus for human spaceflight.
Why Mars? Why is it so important? I mean, there's been an argument, of course, the alternate argument that says singles and doubles are important. Let's get lots of data. Let's get lots of science. Let's not sink so much of the budget into such an expensive thing like a trip to Mars.
Well, so two different things. The trips to Mars are actually quite reasonably priced in the following sense. Talking about robots and rovers. And what I would like to do in my lifetime is send a rover sophisticated enough, sterilized enough to drive up to one of the so-called recurring slope lineae. These are stripes running downhill that are clear, or now it is agreed, are a result of running water every Martian spring. And we would sniff around, look around, microscope examine the ground for living things or evidence of living things. In the meanwhile, what gets people excited about space exploration is when humans go out there. And so we want to get humans in orbit around Mars by, let's say, 2033. If you want to go earlier, 2028, all good. You only go to Mars every 26 months. You can't just go anytime. You have to time it with the orbits. But we strongly feel this would bring out the best in us. It would be optimistic, and we would make discoveries that would change the course of human history.
How so?
Well, I claim that if we found evidence of life on another world, be it Mars or especially the moon of Jupiter, which we call Europa, which has twice as much seawater as the Earth, If we were to find evidence of life out there, it would be like Copernicus, showing that if you want to find the planets in the sky, think of them as going around the sun, not the sun around the planets.
We have a current administration, and perhaps we'll see that the House and Senate do right now, but they seem really intent on cutting funding for science, and yes, cutting the budget at NASA, but definitely turning it, and even looking at things like climate change as suspicious or even untrue.
Well, the problem at NASA, that actually the proposal is to increase the budget, but there's a lot of talk about decreasing the Earth science budget, which is a big part of what NASA does. Even the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration has its own satellites, but many of the instruments aboard those satellites are designed by experts, technicians and engineers and scientists at NASA. So climate change is, for some reason, a political issue. From a scientific standpoint, it's just an issue, a big issue, the most significant issue facing humankind. But our belief is that if we advance space science and exploration at NASA, Earth science will get advanced as well. So we want to keep it all going. But with respect to being anti-science, as much as that's being talked about and as serious as it is, NASA is the best brand, just from a statescraft point of view, just from the State Department's point of view. NASA is the best brand the United States has. So you can invest in NASA for this reason that's not scientific. It's just making or helping people around the world recognize the extraordinary expertise that's been built up here in the United States in space exploration.
Is there one science fact that Bill Nye the Science Guy would throw in the face of those doubting things like climate change?
Well, when it comes to doubting climate change, I encourage everybody to look at the ice. By that I mean look at the ice cores extracted from Antarctica and Greenland, and so occasionally Siberia, and you'll see overwhelming, incontrovertible evidence that the Earth's climate is not just changing, it's changing fast. That's the big problem, everybody. It's the rate at which the climate is changing. And I would love to get involved with all this, but it's humans that are causing it, and the evidence is overwhelming. So the people who are fighting this are the fossil fuel industries, or people the fossil fuel industries have hired. And I really encourage those guys, and they're almost all men, there's a couple women, I really encourage you all to think about your kids, and especially your grandkids. You do not want to leave them a world where people just have to up and move. Our arable land has to move in North America, has to move north. We have to start making new deals with our neighbors to raise enough food for the world. So you guys, this is a really serious issue, and I hope everybody stops making it a political issue and just starts making it a let's get to work issue.
That was the Planetary Society CEO Bill Nye, the science guy. And a quick programming reminder, on Wednesday, starting at 4 o'clock Eastern, the What You Miss team is going to take a deeper look into the rise of populism and how it's changing the dynamics of the global economy. They'll speak with experts on nationalism from around the world, including former ECB President Jean-Claude Trichet, former Italian Prime Minister Mario Monti, and the former Chilean Finance Minister Andres Velasco. You don't want to miss this special hour program at 4 o'clock on Wednesday. Coming up, Uber in the headlines again, and this time it's by choice. The ride-hailing company has released a diversity report. We'll bring you the data next. This is Bloomberg. In the spotlight again, Uber. The ride-sharing company says it'll pull out of Denmark by April 18th. Uber's blaming a new taxi law with requirements like a mandatory meter and seat sensors. Uber has more than 2,000 drivers in Denmark and 300,000 users on its app. The company says they were going to provide dedicated resources, to assist drivers through the shutdown and the exit of Denmark. are staying with Uber after weeks of scandal. The company releasing a report on Tuesday dealing with the gender breakdown and racial makeup of its employees. Data shows the ride-hailing company trails the industry in terms of women in leadership roles or technical roles. Women are only 22% of Uber's leadership team, 15% of the tech jobs. But one piece of data wasn't in the report, retention. That is the percentage of each demographic group who stay with the company every year. Joining us right now from San Francisco, Bloomberg Technologies, Ellen Hewitt. Ellen, thanks for coming on. Tell me about this report. What did it show us? You've seen a lot of these kinds of reports. Was it remarkable?
Yeah, I mean, actually, what's interesting is that it looks a lot like some of the other reports that we've seen coming out of the big tech companies of the Valley, the Google, Twitter, Apple, Facebook. These companies all kind of show a similar pattern, which is very few women and non-Asian people of color in engineering and sort of across the company as a whole, and especially in leadership. Uber, in many ways, is actually quite similar to that. And because they include in their total employee count some of their customer support people, they did have sort of a better racial diversity than some of the other companies that we've seen. But in many ways, it was actually quite in line with some of the other companies that we've been getting reports on for a couple of years.
And I suppose this doesn't include the drivers.
It does not. That is, the drivers remain independent contractors, and they are therefore not included in this. Although there were plenty of people on Twitter that I was seeing tweet that were still a little confused about that.
Right, because they don't want the drivers to be employees because they have to give them things like benefits and worker rights and
health insurance, benefits, yeah. Workers' comp, all these things that they do not want to include. It's been a long legal battle, and the status for now is that they are still independent contractors.
And that's not
same
the
with
only
Lyft, same
right.
with other places.
Well, and that's not the only diversity issue with Uber. We had this former employee come out and say that she was discriminated against because of her gender while working at Uber, and detailed a lot of the problems there.
Yeah, and that's actually the jumping off point for a different story that I wrote this afternoon. It talks about the way that these tech companies' diversity reports do not include retention rates. So, you know, they're happy to talk about, you know, demographic snapshot of what the company looks like, as well as their hiring rates, but they don't really talk about who stays. And, you know, when you talk to people who really study management and diversity, they say that retention rates and who exits, and really whether you might see some demographic groups at a company leaving more frequently than others, is actually a pretty good indicator of what the culture is like inside the company, how inclusive it is. And it's a very important metric. Just people really don't like to talk about it. It's quite sensitive.
Well, and
the Fowler essay is interesting because she talks about how she tried to track the retention rates of her own department herself, you know, because she knew the company wouldn't talk about it, and she was interested in seeing really who's leaving this particular engineering department. And she even says in her essay that the reasons people left, or the reasons women were leaving, was because it was organizationally very chaotic, and that there was also a lot of sexism.
Well, it's also interesting too, because she also suggested that in a perverse way, a diversity initiative at Uber caused her to be forced out of the company.
Yeah, it's interesting. What she says in her essay is that she applied for transfer within teams and that it was blocked, and that she didn't really get good answers from HR on why that happened, and that she says she found out later, and you know, she overheard her manager boasting about how he was able to keep women on his team. This was an engineering team, how he was able to keep them on even when other managers were losing them, and that, you know, we don't know that it was an official policy within Uber that managers were being, you know, graded on their retention rates, but it seemed to me to make it pretty clear that at least within the company, people are paying attention to who is able to keep women in engineering, who is able to keep certain demographic groups within their teams. And also, I think it's important for Uber, probably they track, you know, who stays at the company as a whole. And of course, Stephen Fowler left in December.
So. And it almost suggests, maybe, and they won't tell us, so we can't give them credit for it, that they were maybe at some level trying to do the right thing, or trying to be more diverse, I should say. And yet the way they did it ended up handcuffing them and trying to get the result thereafter.
Yeah, I mean, I think every company is paying attention to this. You know, the sense I get is that they do it in part because they know it's something that outsiders are, you know, that they're under a lot of public scrutiny for, and also because I think there are people within the company that believe it's good for the company, it's good for the business, but it's this mix of the two where I think companies are definitely aware that it's something that they're being watched,
right.
Watched for, and are trying to find their way to, you know, a place that where they find policies that work for them and yeah. you know, where they can sort of make progress.
Interesting story. Ellen Hewitt, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. Wednesday, we're going to look at Samsung as the company releases its highly anticipated Samsung 8. This is Bloomberg.